Now, it's still the month of love, but unfortunately, not all of us will be celebrating the romantic kind of love that others will be celebrating. And that's because we'll be nursing our broken hearts. So today we'll be asking, can a broken heart cause a heart attack? So what are the medical implications of heartbreak? And of course, if you have any questions about your own heartbreak experiences, let us know with the hashtag #BreakfastDaily. The WhatsApp line is 0550-585-832. If you're outside Ghana, the country code is +233. I have been joined by Dr. Kelvin Owusu, who is the medical director of OptimaCare Diagnostics. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
Well, today I'm the love doctor, so I'm fine.
You're always the love doctor, though. So heartbreaks and heart attacks. Is there any connection between the two?
Well, the simple, straightforward answer is no.
Okay.
However.
So we're safe.
However, there's a syndrome called broken heart syndrome.
You're kidding.
Oh, yes, there is. Okay. Which is similar to a heart attack.
Huh.
You know, so that is where the confusion or the similarities are. You know, and as the name suggests, it comes up as a result of emotional situations.
Hmm.
No, in fact, emotional, exciting or shocking situations, that unexpected situations. Something as simple as a surprise party can actually trigger a broken heart syndrome.
You're kidding? How?
Yeah. Well, you are walking into your own house and then suddenly a group of people are shouting, you know, happy birthday. And in the shock, the surprise, it can cause a flood of hormones.
Wow.
The stress hormones can respond. And if you are predisposed, then you could have some symptoms which could be confused or which could be interpreted as a heart attack, you know. But a good thing is that in medicine we say never say never, but people usually don't die or have severe consequences as a result of this broken heart syndrome.
Okay, so before we get to the broken heart syndrome, let's define what a broken heart is, you are the love doctor this morning.
That's not a medical question.
I know. But you said you are the love doctor, so.
Okay.
What are the symptoms of a broken heart? Then we go to the syndrome.
Okay, so basically, I mean, almost everybody has suffered a broken heart before. You have the sadness, the crying, the chocolate. That's for the ladies, actually. I mean, I don't know if the guys also do chocolate, but there's a lot of sadness, definitely a lot of sadness. For some too, it's quite liberating. So it kind of depends on your view to life in general. How you react to this whole concept of broken heart depends on your expectation, how much you are invested in that particular relationship. That will sort of impact your reaction when that relationship is over.
So what goes on internally? Let's say I'm dating this guy. I really like him. I thought we were going to get married. Then I wake up one day and he's like, I can't stand you anymore. I'm out. And then I'm feeling all these emotions. My mind is going crazy.
All over the place.
What's going on inside of me?
So there's a lot of there are a lot of chemicals in our body. We have hormones, we have enzymes, a lot of other things. Now, a lot of the things we go through, the body responds by releasing certain chemicals.
Okay.
So I mentioned something earlier called the stress hormones, something like adrenaline.
Okay.
Adrenaline, the typical example or the typical way adrenaline works is, let's say a lion enters this room right now. You get up and start running without even thinking about where you are. That's usually adrenaline at work. That's the normal function of adrenaline. But sometimes adrenaline released at the wrong time can cause complications.
Ah.
So that's what we mean by, and in fact, that's what is at the base of the broken heart syndrome we are talking about.
Okay.
Now, this guy has left you. You feel used. You are upset. You are very emotional. The body interprets it as stress.
Okay.
And because your body is now interpreting it as stress, it's going to release stress hormones to try and deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
But this is not a stress that you necessarily have to have that kind of response. There's no lion in the room. So why is your body releasing adrenaline? And so the adrenaline being released at that time is not going to be used properly.
Okay.
But it's going to put the body on alert. So the heart is going to respond by beating faster.
Okay.
Exactly, to try and pump more blood, because if that lion had entered the room, you'd need more blood in your legs to start running.
Okay.
So then that's why the heart would beat faster. But at that particular time, you are not going to run. So if your heart is beating faster, it's really not going to achieve much. Mm-hmm. You know, so, but because it's beating faster, you're also going to start breathing a lot faster because it means you need a lot more oxygen. So your lungs are going to open up to bring in more oxygen so that the blood coming into the legs has a lot of oxygen. So you're going to have that response, which is really useless.
You know, because there's no
physical attack. And if it goes on long enough, you are going to become exhausted. And so you are going to have other related conditions. So all these put together, you know, is what we call the broken heart syndrome. So there's going to be tightness of chest. Okay. You know, because when you start running, especially if you haven't run for a while and you just started running, you'd have tightness of chest because your body's not used to running at that intensity so quickly. Mm-hmm. So you'd have the tightness of chest, difficulty breathing, your heart is beating fast, you are sweating profusely, you are eventually become weak, you may even faint. So all these put together, and these are also some of the common symptoms of a heart attack.
Ah.
So that is where the similarities are.
So they're all happening in your heart.
Exactly, in your heart and chest area.
Is there a way to control? Is there a way to get your body to understand that I'm feeling brokenhearted right now, but there's no lion in the room, but just my world is crumbling down?
So that's why I meant. That's why when I started, I said it depends on how much you have invested in that relationship, or what your expectation of that relationship was. That we're going to get married. Probably even bought your things. You've done knocking and all that. The embarrassment. So there's a lot of pressure, social pressure. Most of the heartbreak, what's it called, broken heart syndrome, is a result of social pressure anyway. So how people look at me, and all this puts pressure on your body to cause it to release the hormones to try and respond to these things. So really dealing with this thing is more of a psychological thing than a physical thing, because you need to sort of tell yourself that it's not the end of the world. I mean, there could be another relationship in the pipeline. This is not as bad as it seems. So it's more about reassuring yourself, you know. So words of affirmation, there's really not going to be any medical intervention.
Except so you can't take medicine, even though the symptoms are similar to a heart attack.
Of course, some people will leave it. Because it's so similar, you could end up being put on medication, because at that particular time, at that critical moment, there could be a misinterpretation of the symptoms. Mm-hmm. Especially if maybe the hospital that you are sent to does not have facilities to run the necessary tests for a heart attack. Mm-hmm. They would assume that because of the symptoms you are having, if they look at, for instance, they look at your age, maybe family history, they'll be more cautious, and so they may start your medication. But as I said, most of the time, you don't need medication. Mm-hmm. You just need to reassure yourself that it's going to get better. And so that you can calm yourself down, and then the hormones and the enzymes and all those things will also go down. Mm-hmm. You know. But like I said, most people will end up in hospital. Because if you're having tightness of chest, you're having difficulty breathing,
blurry,
you're sweating,
vision.
Nobody's going to sit down and say, I think this is a broken heart. No, they'll send you to the hospital. But like it usually does not need medical intervention.
Okay.
On the other hand, it could also give a window into your future.
How so?
Because not everybody who has a broken heart ends up in hospital with chest tightness and
sweating
and all that.
But you just said that there are levels to the broken heart.
Yes.
So you might have a broken heart and you're like, listen, I'm a fine guy.
Yeah.
So many women out there. I'm good. I might get it. And I've invested so much into the person. I literally can't see life without him.
But
and that's my world.
So let's stick to the part about the investment. Not everybody who has invested heavily in a relationship gets chest tightness when the relationship doesn't work out. So why are you, you in particular, getting that effect? It's possible that you have some predisposing factors such that when your heart started pumping faster, you started, you know, it's telling you that there's a problem here that you should probably take seriously.
Because in future, it might not be a broken heart. It might actually be
a heart attack that you are going to have in the future.
Ooh, okay.
You know, so even though the broken heart syndrome itself may not necessarily be a medical condition that requires medical intervention, it could be a window to what your future could look like. So especially if you are a bit older and then you've had that experience. Let's say you are 60 and then your children decided to throw a surprise party. And when they shouted, hooray, or, you know, when they jumped up from their bushes and they shouted, you suddenly started hyperventilating and had their chest tightness and all that. It could be the fact, I mean, the whole shock of the experience and the hormones are reacting. But at that point, looking at your age, it could also be that you are actually having a heart attack. Because by 60, most likely, a lot of the predisposing factors are present. You are probably hypertensive. You probably have atherosclerosis in your blood vessels. I mean, you probably have diabetes. All these are symptoms. All these are predisposing factors to a heart attack.
Okay.
And so at that point, the doctor is not going to sit down and say that this is a broken heart syndrome. Every doctor is going to start treatment for a heart attack before later on they realize, oh, okay, it wasn't a heart attack after all.
Mm.
You know, but we're not going to sit back and say that, oh, you know, it could be broken heart syndrome. So let's watch and see.
But how do we manage the symptoms? So you've clarified that it's all mental, it's all psychological. But when it's happening, it feels so real. So how do you calm your nerves so that you don't get to a point where I'm coming to see you on a Monday morning and you're like, Jifa, you don't have a heart attack?
Okay, so I think it begins with knowing yourself. So because if you have been doing regular routine health checks, you know the status of your own vital organs. You know, you are not hypertensive, you are not diabetic, you are active. And when I say active, I mean you do exercise regularly, aerobic exercises. Those are the important ones. The rest are just to look good.
Wow.
Oh, yes,
Dr.
yes. Oh, yes. I mean, aerobic exercise, I'm talking about jogging, swimming, tennis, you know.
But you can work out your muscles. And
when you work out your muscles, like I said, it just makes you look good. It doesn't really add anything to your life.
Okay, you're the doctor, so go ahead.
I mean, you have to work out, you have to look good, but we are talking about things that will impact your cardiovascular system. So now, if you have been doing all these things and you are healthy, and then you suddenly start experiencing these things following some unexpected news, then, you know, because you know you are healthy, you are going to, you know, remind yourself that, okay, I'm healthy, so this is probably not a heart attack. This is probably because of this news I've got. So you're going to try and do and calm yourself down by trying to control your breathing. So take deep breaths, you know. So because by taking deep breaths, it triggers some other chemicals in your body to sort of calm you down.
Okay.
Because once you slow down the rate of breathing, automatically it has an impact on your heart rate.
Ah.
You know, your heart also begins to slow down. So then when your heart now begins to slow down, again, it sends message back to the kidneys
that we pump that much blood.
Don't release any more of those stress hormones.
Okay.
So everything is related. However, if you know that you have a predisposing factor, and I've listed some of them. So if you're hypertensive, if you're diabetic, if you have a family history of heart attack or heart related conditions, when you start experiencing, and the last one, you are old. So you are, 30, 40s, the older you get, the more likely you are to experience a heart attack. So depending on your age, again, you're not going to sit down and say that this is not a heart attack, so let me stay calm and breathe in deep. No, you have to report to the hospital. Because once the process has started, it will take medical intervention to abort it.
Is there a way to differentiate between the two?
Again, it depends on where you're coming from. And when I say, your predisposing factors.
And no, also, as you are feeling it. So let's say you have all these predisposing factors and your partner actually left you.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell that this might be the broken heart syndrome or you can't tell at all?
So you can't really tell. But however, when let's say within 5 minutes you have been able to take in deep breaths and it's actually telling on the fact that your heart is slowing down and the pain is going down and everything is getting better, of course, gives you an idea. But most of the time, in that split second, you yourself, you are confused. So there's really not much you can do.
True.
So you just alert whoever is next to you and tell them, I'm having a problem. Take me to the hospital. Or you yourself, get yourself to the hospital so that the intervention can be started. It's better to have the intervention started and it turns out that it's not a heart attack than to assume it's not a heart attack and then suffer irreparable damage. Because the heart attack is a serious condition.
Yeah.
You know, because the heart pumps the blood to all the parts of the body, we assume that automatically the heart is well fed.
Mm-hmm.
But in actual fact, the heart does not get its nutrition from the blood inside it.
Wow.
There are blood vessels that actually enter the blood, enter the heart muscle. You know, the heart itself is a muscle, it's
yes.
a pump. So there are blood vessels inside the heart muscle that supply the nutrition that the heart needs, the oxygen, all the food that the heart actually needs.
Mm-hmm.
So it is these blood vessels that enter the heart itself that can actually get clogged. Okay, so in this picture, you are seeing that there's been a magnification of some of the blood vessels inside the heart. And it's showing that there's a clogging of the blood vessel. So when the blood is trying to enter the heart muscle to actually nourish the heart, it's not able to go there. And that is when we say you have a heart attack. It means that the muscles beyond where the blockage is are not getting supply. So okay. Imagine you have a watering hole, a water hose, or a watering hose, and then you plug the watering hole, the hose. The water is not going to be able to exit the hose to whatever water the garden around
it's blocked it.
Because it's been blocked. So that's what happens. So the tube inside the heart muscle that's supposed to supply it with blood is blocked, and so the blood is not able to get to the destination. And once blood is not getting to the destination, it means that the heart muscle is not getting food, it's not getting oxygen, and once it's not getting oxygen, it's going to die. So it is the dying muscle that really, that gives you the symptoms of a heart attack. And those symptoms include pain. I think pain is the most dramatic because, I mean, when you watch movies, the person will be standing and, oh, my heart, then they'll hold their chest and then they'll collapse or something. So pain is usually the thing that most people would notice first.
Okay.
However, not everybody will have pain. And this is important, especially if you are diabetic. A lot of diabetics can have a heart attack that has no pain.
How so?
Because of the pathophysiology of diabetes itself, it can affect the nerves, because the nerves that will transmit the pain, the nerves
have gone numb.
Yes, so some in diabetics, a lot of the nerves have gone numb.
Okay.
So then they cannot even experience the pain.
Wow.
So they may experience something like chest tightness. I can't breathe well. I mean, I'm or you are breathing fast or faster than normal. I'm having chest tightness, difficulty breathing. You know, for those who still experience the pain, sometimes the pain can radiate into your jaw. So you have pain on your left side radiating into your jaw. You feel the pain going up into your jaw, or it goes down into your left hand. So that's usually the classic symptom of the heart attack pain.
Okay.
You have pain in your chest, your left side of your chest, which goes up into your jaw or down into your left hand. So when you notice anything like that, you know it's quite telling that there's something going on, especially looking at your age and your predisposing factors like hypertension, diabetes. You need to take it more seriously. Some people will also have things so non-specific, like nausea and vomiting.
Really?
Yes.
How?
So, well, again, it's in the chest. And you know, the stomach, the esophagus connects to the stomach in the chest region.
Yeah.
So it could in some way affect the motility in the stomach and the what's it called, the esophagus, and then cause the nausea and vomiting. So it could be something as unrelated as that.
And you get a heart attack.
And that is actually you having a heart attack.
Wow.
You know, so it's not everybody who has the classic pain going up and down symptom. Some people also have dizziness.
Yeah.
Blurry vision, yes. Some people too will have irregular heartbeat. Again, the heart, there are a lot of things in the heart.
Very complex.
You know, when you watch movies, they draw the heart like that. The heart is not really, it's not like that at all. It's actually some funny shape. It's shaped like a pear or something like that.
Wow.
You know, and there's a portion of the heart which actually generates an electrical impulse.
Okay.
Which is what tells the rest of the heart to start beating. So that's why the heart beats. So if you watch documentaries, the heart beats in a very synchronized manner. The upper part will beat, the lower part will beat.
Oh, so even if all you beat, feel your own
yes,
heart.
Yes, exactly. So that's why they actually two
rhythms.
Yes, two rhythms. Beep, 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 beep. Yes, that's actually how the heart's supposed to work. Now, if this part of the blood vessel that is blocked is the blood vessel that supplies where the electrical impulse is generated, you are going to have irregularity in your heartbeat.
Wow.
And so sometimes you might actually notice that my heart is not beating as regularly as it's supposed to. You know, that could be a sign that you are about to have a heart attack, or you're actually having a heart attack.
Okay, so Dr. Kelvin, there are people watching us who may have hurt someone in the past or are planning to. Any advice to them on keeping all this in mind when you are planning on breaking somebody's child's heart? So that you can deliver it in a way that they don't end up going to the hospital to think that they have a heart attack and they don't.
Well, the first warning is that this week, no breakups.
You're not allowed somebody's heart.
No. We don't want any breakups this week. That's the first advice, because everybody is anticipating what's going to happen on Friday. So we don't want any flood of non-emergency cases entering the hospitals and causing us to miss the actual emergency. So please,
don't do that.
No breakups this week. Very important.
Thank you. And that's coming from the doctor.
You know, however, I mean, as much as possible, let's try and be empathetic or sympathetic, because you are in the relationship. You know, definitely you talk. You know what the other party's expectations are of the relationship. So let's try not to be too abrupt in our breakups, you know, especially if you know that this person is an overly emotional individual who overreacts to certain things. Definitely, if the breakup is unexpected, it's going to have a telling effect on that individual. So we need to be mindful of who we are dating and how we communicate such news to the person. Again, like I said, the broken heart syndrome is not only about people who end relationships. It can also affect people in other circumstances. So whatever news you are breaking to somebody, we need to take that person's state of mind into consideration so that you don't just break information about, let's say, your mother is dead.
Yeah.
You know, you have to do it in a nicer way. And again, same with the media. Sometimes you turn on the TV and then you see that breaking news, this person is dead. The family has not even been notified and it's on the news. And now today on social media, it's even worse, you know, because people literally live to break news. So they chance on an accident and their first response is to pick their phone and take a picture, take the car number plate. So if you are browsing on the internet and then you know that your partner or whoever is on the road and they take such a picture and the number plate, immediately your heart can skip a beat, and that could be the beginning of your own issues.
So we should all try to be a bit more empathetic.
Very, very true.
With the way we deliver these news, because it might affect the person.
Yes.
And we don't want any more, you know, heartbreaks, heart attacks.
Especially this week.
Especially this week and the rest of the month, and hopefully the rest of the year. Where do we follow your social media?
Well, I'm on Facebook at Kelvin Owusu, MD. Okay. And then the others would follow.
And next week you bring my chocolate.
Yes, I will.
Thank you for staying with us. So remember, we don't want anyone going to the hospital, okay? And you can get triggers that might look like heart attacks, but it's not really a heart attack. So if you're heartbroken, just breathe, 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 and get your nerves to calm down so that they know that whatever you're feeling is actually psychological and it's not actually happened. The tiger is not in front of you. No one is going to kill you. You're just heartbroken.
We hope you've enjoyed the show. Make sure you subscribe, like, comment, and share with your friends. This is Breakfast Daily on City TV.
Join the Breakfast Daily team Monday through Fridays from 7:30 a.m. to 10. Join us for breakfast daily, only on City TV.